proud to be today in Seoul with this partnership between Hawking Galleries and the Kiak Art Seoul, with the Royal Gallery Weekend for the third time. Key art conversation allow us to think, to better understand that what is happening in the art world regarding the market, collecting practices, communication strategies, or how we conceive art spaces. Hawking Galleries was born in Barcelona in 2011, and the reason was because galleries share so many moments, the fairs, the openings, but we don't have a specific space to discuss our profession and experiences. This concern led me to the foundation of Hawking Galleries, conceived as a platform for industry professionals, focusing on the discussion on key issues for the gallery sector at a time of economic crisis, with a specific mission to help to provide service to the entire artistic ecosystem. The project is now growing. This November we will launch an educational area. The London Purse will be the first of a series of programs aimed at practicing an emerging gallerist. It's a small seed towards an academy for gallerists. In 2019, we'll have editions in Barcelona, next January, the city where it was born, and Paris, Dubai, London, and Brussels. Seoul is one of the most important Asian capitals. This is the reason why we are so excited to be here again. We are looking forward to sharing our views and be part of this thrilling event. Special thank you to speakers that came from abroad. Some of them are already part of our community, like Georgina Adam, Marie Klassen, Rebecca Taylor, Delna Vida, or Ken Nefkins, who have already collaborated with us in previous meetings. All these will be speakers in tomorrow's sessions. I would like to especially welcome newcomers to our project by Jing Liu and Tateo Nakajima that will give a start our program in a few minutes. Lastly, allow me to thank the organization team for their dedication and compromise, especially Sol Garcia, who is now in the stage, our general coordinator, and Yuna Park, coordinator of the Kiak team, for their good job. I hope you enjoy the discussion. Thank you very much.
Oh, yes. So hello, thank you, Lucien. And just a few words to introduce our first talk that is titled Art and Architecture Think Spaces for Art. So we are proud to have here Tateo Nakajima and Jing Liu to talk about the role of architecture in shaping the cultural landscape. So about the relationship art and architecture, and they will do their brief presentations on their experiences and projects. We will start with Tateo. Tateo is former orchestra conductor, acoustical expert, and now he is an internationally recognized leader in the design and planning of performing arts venues, and he is currently principal of ARUP. As you may know, ARUP is one of the world's largest independent firm of designers, planners, engineers, technical specialists, and the firm behind many of the world's best-known buildings, maybe the Sydney Opera House is one of their most well-known. And Tateo, before joining ARUP, was partner and principal auditorium designer with Artec Consultants, working on the theater planning and auditorium acoustics aspects of the wide range of projects. Tateo has overall design and management is responsibility for projects ranging from concert halls, opera houses, to pop entertainment venues in the Americas, Europe, and Asia on an ongoing basis. Tateo will share us like this more conceptual approach on how architecture is conceived for art and cultural spaces. Following, we will have Jing Liu coming from New York. Jing is co-founder of the architectural studio Seoul in 2008 with Florian Edenburg. Seoul is an internationally recognized architecture and design firm based in New York. They specialize in urban spaces, buildings for culture, residences and workplace on a variety of scales. And especially in culture buildings, maybe those who are from Seoul know that they are the firm behind the space for Gucci Gallery. But she will then introduce us to other main projects focused on arts. So Tateo, now please, it's your turn. Thank you very much.
Good morning. Pleasure to be here again. Seoul is a city that we feel very strongly about, and I personally have a lot to work in. I'm currently working on the concert hall in Jing as well, and so it's a pleasure to be here to talk to you today. I'm talking to you today, obviously, about something other than performing arts spaces. The team I lead in London is part of a global practice that deals with arts, culture, and entertainment spaces in general. And when we talk about arts, culture, and entertainment, we are always very well grounded in the thoughts and the premise that binds ARUP as a whole around concepts of integrated design, but really about creating spaces and places and experiences that are cultural, big and broad. The broad palette. So, and we live in a time when things are changing. All of our audiences are set with a lot more options. They are expecting things that are more digitally enhanced, they're expecting spaces that are better integrated, ergonomic, easier, and in a strange way, also more impactful and more meaningful. And how we navigate this world where culture has become more commoditized as a product, as an entertainment or as a value product is something that we're quite interested in, because we truly believe that culture is at the foundation of who we are as communities, as societies. And so ARUP is, of course, very grounded in the built environment, physical and virtual, I'd like to say. And thinking about how this built environment helps us to be sustainable and cultural, to have environments and experiences that are rooted in a place, in a time, in a context, in a community, and at the same time, how those can be resilient and flexible so that as those communities need to be changed, need to respond to external pressures, they can do so in a way that is not generic from place to place around the world. And this is a challenge, I think, that as the designers are brought to work in different places is even more important. We work in a wide range of things, places, so from concert halls to virtual reality experiences, to galleries to public spaces, from historical venues to broadcast spaces, master planning, sound and art experiences, experiences using light. And these are, it's through the range of experiences that we have around the world and working with multiple skills and different architects, different creatives, that we build, I think, a value to the profession, to the industry in designing these spaces. We're very proud of the work we do. We work around the world, and this gives us this texture of and a perception of how things, what can be good and what should be different in each place. And at the end of it always comes back to the fact that these are human interactions with each other, human interactions with art, a way that we as individuals and communities grow, evolve, and find identity, and refine and redefine our identities. So I'm going to talk a little bit about what we find are important things that we talk about a lot in our work as we work with other creatives, architects, engineers, our clients, and some questions we ask. We will touch on some of the tools that we have developed to help that conversation, as well as the thinking that might go in the earlier phase. So, for us, designing an environment has its foundation, a belief that good design makes a difference. And for everybody in this room, that might be an obvious thing, but for the building industry, sometimes I wonder whether it is an absolute automatic thought. Because actually, if you design, if you decide on a texture, a shape, light, not light, temperature, all of this affects us in intellectual, in conscious, and subconscious ways. And so the premise is, we can not only design to avoid problems, but we can design to achieve an impact. And that then has to start with, what do you want to achieve? What is the message you're creating? And therefore, well, how do you design the environment to allow those messages, that message, those messages, to be communicated? We've all experienced those places that have problems, right? Places where you can't understand what's going on. Because maybe there are conflicts between different sources at the same time. We've also seen places where light has conflicts because of natural light against video screens, or places where there's so much going on that you can't actually understand what you're supposed to be reading and how. Or places where perhaps in different times of day you really can't understand what that was supposed to be. Or perhaps there's an overkill of technology because there's so many lamps, and maybe it could have been done in a way that was both more discreet, economical, and effective. And finally, we think a lot about queuing and how those public spaces are used at different times of the day. Galleries in particular can see massive differences between week Monday mornings and Saturday mornings. And these differences are things that we think we should be able to control. So as a basic premise, we believe that shaping experience has a direct correlation with shaping environment. And that this belief comes in my personal world from the work we do in concert halls, which has a lot to do with sound, but also architecture and how you feel the space and how those things work together in a very pure way. So moving on to tools then, we have a practice at ARUP that is very much driven by innovation from the young people and the creative spirit that we have in our team. So Sound Lab is something that has been one of those things where younger professionals coming into the firm maybe 10 years ago brought with them the thinking from Paris at IRCOM and said, we should be able to talk about sound in a more tangible way with our clients. Very often when you talk about an acoustical environment, you're talking in numbers that nobody really can understand. Is it, you know, reverberation time or absorption? And there's a gap, I think, of understanding. And the Sound Lab is an oralization suite that allows you to actually listen and make decisions together. So if we go back to the same difficult space, on the left-hand side,
if you could press the button.
We can actually have the clients be part of deciding whether we want more absorption or less absorption, and start to think about what sort of experience acoustically you want to provide. So the different levels of absorption can be decided, not by some numerical metric, but actually by this equally in this sort of very dense gallery, size gallery environment where you have many different now multimedia sources. You can actually model and compare how things will sound in a 3D environment so that you can be saying, ah, I want, when somebody enters the room, I want them to notice something there or understand what's going on here without being bothered by somewhere else. So these are now things that we can work on together. And this whole technology has also led to creative collaborations with artists and installation artists and sound artists as we create virtualized spaces for artistic experience that might be in full performance mode or, for that matter, in an immersive art installation. And has led recently to our work as the sound designer and sound VR coordinator for the world's first VR opera, for example. This work about making the virtual audio and their virtual digital environment, something that's tangible and planable, is one part of what we work on. And so thinking about how sound can become directional, how sound is wayfinding, how sound is experienced, how sound adapts to the number of people and the nature of what's inside is something we think about. We also think about light, how light can set both character, a rhythm, an identity of a place. It can also be a wayfinding tool and how you can actually get a sense of hierarchy, a sense of exploration through these tools. And of course, we can now model how light, natural light, and video can work together by studying how daylight can go through a space and looking at that different times of the day. And of course, with architectural lighting as well, we're now using 3D modeling in a virtualized space, virtual reality to make sure that the architecture and the light work together and that the light temperature is all controlled. And again, these are also attributes and skills that we use in installations for performance art and other artistic collaborations. And of course, again, the concept that light can be part of shaping your experience in space together with the architecture, together with the exhibit design, is something that we feel very strongly. And finally, this is a, can you press the video button actually on this one? We have been doing a lot of work on getting insight into people's movements so that we can, with cueing and ticketing, actually model behavior, randomized behavior in galleries, as well as in intermission when you're having events going on. How do people use space? How do you better plan it? How can you actually make sure that when you have peak times that you have enough capacity? And how do you deal with that? This is not something that is now just empirical, but actually can be modeled. And we are always looking for different tools that allow us to have more sophisticated work, conversations about that. So all of this is about collaboration and the interaction between built environment and experience. And ultimately, we feel that really design comes to intent. And so there are a lot of questions we ask very beginning at the beginning of the project about who space is for, what sort of experience is necessary. We were talking earlier about the fact that very often in galleries you have changing exhibits, but what is it about the space that doesn't, by its flexibility, become completely bland and identityless? And how do you actually balance those things? In much of our work, whether it's in visual arts or in performing arts, we talk about cultural character, and we talk about what people are looking for in these spaces as a basis to actually start a design process. It's no longer enough, I think, to have a process that starts with how many square meters do you want to have. That's a very important measure. But equally important is, as the client, as the cultural operator, as the entity that is going to own and operate the space, what sort of experience do we want to offer? And so very often we actually do design research at the very beginning. We actually ask these questions, develop a concept, test it. And a lot of these are about watching people, about ethnography, about surveys, about market research, and actually studying even real-time data, which is something recently we've been doing, for example, at the V&A in London, where we are doing a complete overlay of what people want out of the place, how they experience it, what can we offer that will enhance that experience, parse it, and make people feel more connected with the institution. And finally, I'll leave with the thought that is perhaps a bit more controversial, which is that because design is about intent, and because designers, I would say, really seek somebody to discuss with, something to react to, I think there are real questions about how we procure, how we design, how we initiate a conversation about design of the built environment around cultural experience. What comes first? When do we intervene? And how can we actually improve through also process the outcomes that ultimately make the industry more sustainable? Thank you.
Thank you, Tateo. Thank you very much. Very interesting. Your this
general introduction on how you and your team conceive design of cultural spaces for human experience. Jing Liu, no? Yes, return to your presentation.
Which is a very agricultural university that predominantly the students' bodies are in the winery business, I mean, wine business and agriculture production business. And to make an art building, a contemporary art building on my campus is something very, it has a lot of responsibilities, so, because we're introducing art to a community that art maybe wasn't talked about so much there. So you're introducing art for the first time into the community. And instead of this very kind of regulated and very production-oriented landscape and cultural, to introduce something that's more flexible and that's more evolving and becoming, and something that's more open and more of a platform of exploration, it was the topic of our design intention discussions in the beginning. So we were very inspired by that agricultural and agrarian landscape, and you just saw that was very regulated and very much about overproduction and efficiencies into something that's more fluid and drew these lines that's not straight and started to draw the lines that's more flexible. And we also allowed the lines to rise and fall in the space, so it's not just something that's horizontal for maximum efficiency. And we understand that galleries often have to make straight walls. But how do we introduce this more open-ended and more playful space in it was a challenge. But you can see that what we did, maybe it's better to see it in the plan, what we did is to place the galleries as boxes and straight walls in the landscape, but then allow those lines to really become more fluid and more curved outside of the gallery spaces in public space. So all the education space, public space, and even outdoor space that also functions as outdoor performance and galleries and outdoor art space to be something that's much more inviting and playful and much more connected to the outside. So 40% of the building we decided to place it on the outside, and so they're not covered interiors. They're not interiors, but they're covered exteriors. And in the kind of Northern California, the sun is really intense and very strong. So to make the outside actually conducive for people and these activities, the shape is very important to design that. So we studied endlessly on how to give a sense of changing shadows throughout the day in this outdoor space so that the outside is activated and people there and how that becomes more inviting and enticing. The solution was a very simple one in the end, which is this triangle with a beam that covered the entire canopy. And all the interior space are tucked behind under the grand canopy, as we call it. So what you see effectively is not a building, it's more of a roof, it's an environment, and then it's an environment that draws you in, and it's an environment that's constantly active throughout. And once you're under the canopy, you see the building, which is very transparent, because we intentionally put the glass programs that could be transparent, so not the galleries on the perimeter of the interior space. And the lobby itself becomes a public living room, so anyone can come in, there's no checking desk until you get to the in front of the galleries. And we try to have every gallery have a sense of a space as well, so it's always the experience of the art is always connected to the outside. Now I know that it's very difficult to convince always museum directors to go for the daylight galleries, but I think when it's in the main direct, it's much more manageable. So this is another project that I just mentioned, the Kuche Gallery. Here we have a different challenge, which is inserting the contemporary art space in the one of the most historically significant neighborhoods in Seoul. So it's right across the street from the Imperial Palace. We knew when we started the project that there were a lot of opposition in the neighborhood in contemporary art galleries coming into the neighborhood at the time, and also having a contemporary architecture to be blended with the historical district. So galleries needed to have the right proportion and needed to have a certain scale. But how do you make that scale and that abstract form more in dialogue formally and and aesthetic with the very historical context was our challenge. So we wanted to make a building that maybe is not so much talking aggressively at its content, but recedes and have a little bit of softness when it touches down, and also develop itself with this ambiguity, visual ambiguity, that was not very aggressive to its historical context. So how do we make a building that's elastic and that's ambiguous? We found this chainmail mesh, which often used as a butcher cloth and belly dancing costume, which has this seductive but also strong connotations to the relationship with the audience. So we used that to actually create the facade of the gallery building. And we also wanted to very much explore this idea of crafts, because the historical buildings has such a sense of craft. There were a lot of people that built those buildings coming home with a big hand and very, very fine details that ages very well over time. So how do you make contemporary art architecture to have that same sense of crafts? We went to China, to a city that has 2,000 workshops that only work with stainless steels and a lot of them well for kitchen utensils for the whole entire globe. And then we told them that let's make architecture together. So we got to the village together and started to build this facade, which is 500,000 stainless steel rings hand welded together. So it took 8 months to weld all of this together, and we rented the local car shop to finish the panels after they were welded, and we rented the backyard of the local schools to do the first mock-up. It was a very, it took a village to create this facade for this day. And then the result of it is that it's a quite a large building in comparison to the Hanok homes around it, but somehow it's like this elephant that disappears, and you don't really see the building or see the object until you're really at the foot of it. And then because of the elasticity of the facade, the same steel facade, that it draped around all these accessory programs, so the staircase and the vestibules and the elevators around the entire space, and then created this very, the inside is very abstract and rectangular, and the outside is actually very soft and malleable. Underground we have theater space, and you can see this more soft and curvature, curved forms that work very well with the topology of the kind of forms around it. And at the edge, the light comes, both the daylight comes into the galleries, but also comes out of the galleries. And this is the Freeze Art Gallery, Freeze Art Fair in New York that they helped organize in the first 3 years. I think many of you might have visited. And this is a very simple project, and a simple question, and a simple answer that I came up with, which is this. When they came to us, they said we need to make this 1.5 kilometer long tent for the gallery, for the fair. And this is going to be the shape because we're all using the tent materials and stock tent structures. So we got it and we said, well, that's a shame because this is along this beautiful stretch of the East River in New York. It has a great view. And I personally have been to art fairs many times, and it's often a dreadful experience when you cannot get out of it. After 20 minutes, you get completely overwhelmed. So I said, why don't we try to look at the plan? I know that this is a fair, it needs to be very, very rational, but let's just think about customizing a few pieces, and maybe we can make this a more pleasant experience. And an experience that really taking the magnificent view and the waterfront opportunities that's so rare in New York. So what came out of it is this serpentine shape that hung around the bank of the river, and it actually made it the tent even longer than it's straight along because of the serpentine shape was able to negotiate the different topographical specificities on the site. And we worked very hard to put all the mechanical and service component of the ferret in the interior so that we created a whole water site for sculpture gardens, food trucks, and terraces for the visitors to come in and out freely. And also in, on the inside of the fair, you get a little bit more generous bend as a spatial experience on the inside. And the light, we also got rid of all the mechanical from overhead of the tent and put it under the the floor of the tent. So we were able to get indirect daylight, this diffuse daylight into the tent. I think one of the magazines said that be aware that the art in Freeze Art Fair looks much better than probably your living room, so be careful when you buy it. the reason we were able to create the serpentine shape is because we consolidated all public amenities, so the resting rooms and cafe and restaurant in these wedges, and we customized with the stock structure. And because the galleries cannot have triangular space, it's also natural to have this triangular space, the wedge space, as we call it, as the public amenities. So they become more like a plaza in this 1.5 kilometer tent. And the last project I'm going to briefly touch on is a completely different context. It's in this hyper-commercialized environment in Hong Kong. You also mentioned that the commodification of art in a lot of geographic locations in the world these days. The question here is, how do you create an art experience and art environment that's both embedded within the everyday life of the people, but also, like the soap bubble, exert a little bit of the special expectations. So this what we needed to do is for the Chen family in Hong Kong, Agent Chen is the chairman of the Art Center, or Art Foundation, as some of you know, came to us and wanted to do this project with us. So we needed to insert a 10,000 square meter art space in the development of his family along the waterfront in Hong Kong. We didn't want to make a museum that was solid, which would be the obvious answer, because as a museum, we don't need glass walls. But the context around it is so much about shopping, and there's so much glass, and so how do we create something that's not in contrast too much with it and fighting with it, but still somehow differentiate itself and creating that special expectations. So this image, Margaret's painting, really inspired us to create maybe a facade or the threshold and edge that both let things in and also reflected back and creates this double two-directional facade. So we created, we used glass, a 9 meter tall glass column to envelop the entire art space around it. It both creates a completely different monumental scale around the facade of the gallery or the arts program, and it doesn't fight too much with the very commercialized architecture around it. So the facade is made up of 475 of this 1 meter diameter colonnade that's made out of glass, each one of them is about one ton, and then they get hoisted basically from the water directly up to the facade. We were able to do that only because this building is right on the water edge of the Victoria Harbor. So this is the length of each of the glass tubes. And because they're so heavy, most of it is automatically, the production is completely automated and it was done outside of Barcelona. And the building is almost finished. Next year, the building will open and the art space will open the following year. So you can see that the glass is completely transparent, but because of the geometry and the curvature, it also reflects the surroundings in a very seductive way, I would say. to share.
Thank you, Jing, for sharing your insights and your architectural practice through these examples of cultural projects. So, starting with you thinking more on spaces for contemporary art and drawing from some concepts you both mentioned about the problems, yes, that Tateo when facing a project, and also these tensions between space, function, and design. In the case of spaces for contemporary art, and mainly through this tradition, or let's say from the Pompidou's to Guggenheim Bilbao, you know, where the space, the building becomes an icon. You know, how do we, how do you, this conflicts of the inside and the outside, or the function for contemplation for art, and the building becoming an icon, how do you work? How do you conceive, how do you think, reflection on this? In the sense of how do architect spaces can serve work of arts, and not the other way around. Maybe it's more thinking in gallery spaces. Which problems do you face in this? We can see the one having a commission.
Yes, I think for us, you know, the architecture always has to, especially architecture for the arts, has to deliver some sense of wonder and sense of contemplation. It has to create a filter from the everyday clutters in the world, and because that's what also people expect when they come to a space for the arts. I mean, it doesn't really matter if it's public or private program. We just talked about this morning that in a lot of countries, the gallery and the museums are interchangeable, especially in the expectation of the public. So they come here because you know, this, even if they're not, the audience are not versed and understand art, you know, they're not involved in art in their professions, there's this myth about they still come to be satisfied with that expectation. So I do think that it's important for the building to have this moment of wonder and this suspension from the everyday life. But on the other hand, if it has no connection with people's experience there, it also feels very much something like helicopter ink, and it's, for that matter, international style or kind of globalism that has no relationship with the life of the people. So then if you don't have that environment to come into the experience of art, it's also very difficult for the experience of art to influence the everyday life back into the everyday life. So we're very conscious of creating this you know, careful balance of both being rooted and connected to the experience, the experience of the context, and also creating wondrous enough out of it. And we know that actually working with art clients for decades, that it's very difficult to reinvent the typologies of galleries. We tried many times, and it's the gallery, it's the gallery. So our moment of intervention often is the public space in the way that people would, before they enter the galleries, and also sometimes the experience from one gallery to the other. I didn't mention today, we do a lot of exhibition design as well, and we try to rethink the way people going from one room to the other that might not be so prescriptive, but more exploratory, very much to, similar to our way of browsing the internet listings that you can curate and create your own personal experience.
And thank you, reflection also on the challenges now and in the near future, but also contemporary art practices where media, technology are already in use, and how do you think, how do you adapt, or how do spaces for art, no? I don't see this, when museums are not only for bi-dimensional works. No?
I think it's not only the nature of the work that's interesting in that question, though, because what we're finding is that organizations that are presenting curating are going through organizational change because of technology. The way they communicate with their interact with their communities becomes broader. So what is available digitally, remotely, virtually, in situ or not, starts also to change a lot of the meaning, perhaps, between the connective tissue and gallery spaces, or for that matter, the way the entire building talks to its environment. One of the things that I always hope for in projects is that that striving of how it communicates with the environment is not only about integration, but about identity, right? So there is a question of not scale and integration, but often these buildings tend to be bigger than everybody necessarily wants them to be. So questions of softness, questions of scale, these are of course important, but actually sometimes it's also about having an intent that then the design team and architects and architects can interpret. And I think a large part of that has to be from the clients. Clients really should allow themselves to go on that journey, not just to say we want something, but actually to have an opinion that evolves together in that creative journey with the design team to say what it should be, what do we want to say, what do we need to be able to do.
Tateo, when you mentioned this, design, you know, has premises to communicate a message, you know, of this identity, but also design has to avoid problems, conflicts. Thinking more in the future, what challenges do you think spaces, performance spaces, or cultural spaces you work with has to face, or which problems do you envisage to deal with in this shifting of audiences and experiences?
I think we touched on it, what I see as the next challenge. I don't know how far forward I can see, any better than anybody else. But I feel like across arts and culture, we have gone from being something that was very well embedded in the lifestyles of a certain part of society to something that has become accessible to a larger portion of society, which is good. But in doing so, went through a period of, I would say, commoditization and distribution as being the primary focus, and somehow in doing so, lost contact a little bit with context and a more curated experience. So one of the things that we are seeing more and more is bringing back to the community to really try to find something about experiences that is not about scale, it's not about having more, it's about having a more meaningful relationship. And so creating spaces that are more than efficient. They should be efficient. They should be energy efficient, they should not create congestion, should be safe, all these things, let's take for granted, but actually should be more than that. So that having one of these assets, it becomes something that is not an asset anymore, but actually becomes the heart of a community. And the community can be virtualized, it could be not geographically bounded, but a community feels that that is something where they want to, that they align themselves with, they spend time, they want to belong, they want to explore, they want to re-explore, because it allows them things together that they can't do on their own. I think we need more spaces, and we need to constantly strive to do that. If we do that, then we start to say, okay, this one is this, that one's different. And we're not artificially creating differences, but naturally they evolve. that allows us to have more of these experiences and less of these rather shopping mall-like experiences where you're going and there's just more and more. And I have to leave after 10 minutes because it's just too much.
I just want to say that this is actually a moment, although everyone is talking about commodification and Instagram followers for institutions and you know, galleries. And I also, as an archivist, kind of we are constantly on the demand of thinking about, okay, how do we create Instagrammable moments, right? Like it's one of the mandates, unspoken mandate for everyone, all the clients at this moment. So we have to sometimes produce even renderings to show that, okay, this is the Instagram moment, right, in this building. And as a teacher, I teach in the university as well, and often we have to even think about our assignment as, you know, can it be Instagrammable? And this is a completely new paradigm, but actually within this paradigm, I'm very fortunate every day that we're actually creating experience that's tangible and it's only communicated through people being there. So obviously we're aware of the creating the Instagram moment, because that's incredibly important. And but also I think for the longevity of any place to stay alive and stay still creating new Instagram all the time, it still has to have that experience, authentic experience that's deeply embedded in the space and time, and that people would be able to use it all the time and create new content and new shows, flexible enough, but also allow like moments of that festivity to come into that space so that it can be the background, right, for new content all the time. So I think as an archivist, I'm more and more appreciative that we are able to create that experience, not just the one to feel loved in the Instagram event. Because that gets, if that doesn't evolve and change over time,
you only need once, basically, right.
Interesting how an architect has to where physicality is for real space, no? Now virtual space for instantaneous it's quite challenging.
But I find the challenge comes again, not to point fingers, but the challenge comes again from a general feeling that what I challenge is the goal. Because if the goal, I find that the number of people who come is very much dependent on a lot of different factors. What's more interesting for me in the long term, not ignoring the short term, but the long term actually is, I feel proud of venues that I hear talked about thousands of miles away. Right? That's not about an Instagram moment actually, or people who travel to go to a place because that it's memorable. These were people who say, I go every week. This is the sort of relationship that ultimately creates sustainability, not how many Instagram hits you get. And I think while there's nothing wrong with wanting both, it's always an evolving discussion with our clients as to how to define that value that we're trying to achieve beyond some metrics that they themselves may have to show to others.
Sure, yes. But it's also we can't get rid of this Instagram experience now.
Well, there are real discussions, though. No. I think there's questions about, I think there are questions asked at conferences in the profession about whether or not you really want people to be so distracted from what's going on that they actually want to in social media. I mean, isn't the goal actually to get them past it so they're not even thinking about it? These are real questions, but yes, that's something we have to deal with.
Okay. At least we don't a new social network appears actually. I would like to open up to our audience if there's any question to raise to our speakers. You're welcome.
was wondering, because this was mostly about, I mean, your part was more about the inside space, but your part was mostly about outside space, and I know that an art review has to have some kind of icon, character, but I'm thinking about, do you actually also interact with artists about the chain of art, so that art maybe needs something different than just straight white walls or something? Is this something you talk about?
Yeah, but I think artists would always challenge the space that they exhibit anyways, so it's almost useless to design a space for a specific type of art. You know, these days everyone's doing performing and multimedia, who knows what's going to happen in 2 years. Buildings last much longer than the medium of art transforms. I mean, a lot of people are doing more paintings and photography again these days. So, and I feel like you can design for one specific medium, but the artists will challenge it anyways. So, in terms of scale, in terms of
yeah, I'm just thinking about the straight white wall, so it doesn't have to be space, more be living, and more.
Most of the artists that we talk to actually just like no distractions around their art, so straight white walls are still the most popular one, I think. We try to challenge that too, but. So what about the performing arts space?
Well, I was just thinking that performing arts actually is an interesting discussion, because art forms probably morph slower, in part because a lot of them are collaborative arts, so effectively you have to get more people to agree to do that, and so that's part of it. But there's a very big difference, I find, between projects that are intended or driven by a single artist, who has at least the concept at that point in time that they want that sort of space and they want to do this, be able to do this with the art form, and those that are almost have mandates to be able to deal with a wider range of artists, and no space is ultimately for one type of artist. But we're working on a studio for an artist right now, where the entire space is designed for the sound characteristics that he wants. And when I'm working with any ensemble or any city, we try to find a signature for a sound experience that is different from everywhere else. But it's quite a different experience when you're dealing with one artist, because then you can go further into individualization. You're creating something that may not be as broad in its ability to flex as other ones, just because people will understand they're going into this artist's studio. So the goal as defined with the client was almost like visiting Picasso's studio. I mean, there's a pilgrimage aspect, but then because of a certain style at that time, that artist wants that sort of environment. So it depends. I mean, most of our work inevitably has to achieve a fairly broad palette while still delivering character, but there are some exceptional environments where we're working with specific art pieces in the visual arts world, in which case you can design around it, permanent exhibits, or in performing arts around the specific artists. In some ways, that's more fun.
Maybe the white wall is not so much challenging, but at the scale, I think this morning we talked a little bit about this idea of the bigger the better, common free space and a completely flexible space is a myth that is the best, because a lot of museums built in the last 5 years has realized that this huge column free space is incredibly expensive to manage. Every time you do a show, you have to build so many temporary walls, and you have to hire designers to conceive how to subdivide it, what's the narrative, and we've been involved in a project that we designed the exhibition, and then they said, okay, we're not going to get it done anymore, we're just going to keep using it, in a big space. And because actually you need a more varied, different scale of space to be able to accommodate a portfolio of different spaces.
part that I think is, again, in formats we had the same sort of thing after. At a certain point in time, artists wanted so much flexibility that you ended up with a black box. The black box is effectively, architecturally speaking, a non-space. Right? You have gone so far into a non-space that your real black box was a found space, but you painted black so that the actual details don't bother you. It's a non-architectural space. And somehow, we've come back to, and if you watch the artists, they like found spaces. The reason they like found spaces is not because it's more convenient, it's because it has personality. So the premise that more flexibility actually creates an environment for better art is true for some art, but generally speaking, we're finding that finding creative ways to perhaps keep the blank white wall, but actually create a frame around an experience that still has that personality, regardless of what comes into it, whether it be the ceiling or other factors, it's very important, because otherwise there's no sense of where you are or why you're there, and that skill is a big part of that. We were both talking earlier about not liking the word flexibility, and I think that needs to be taken into the concept that we completely understand the need for flexibility, but very often flexibility leads to something that is not interesting, and somehow that tension is really quite important for any cultural environment, because it has to deliver a cultural experience, which can happen.
Okay, here we have a question.
Yes, regarding the sound of the spaces you were talking about, it looks like the white cube, this miniature white cube, is not the perfect space for some performance or for some work of an audio, like video. How do you think these white cubes can evolve to allow these pieces to sound to be perfect in their pieces?
So first of all, let me say it has nothing to do with the color. And it's not about the shape either necessarily. It all comes down to, for that particular question of, you know, if you are not wanting to have a cacophonic experience, a lot of that is about absorption. So it's about, if you have something that looks like a simple white space, it's about making sure that the materiality has some perforations or whatever so that we can absorb sound. That I think is manageable as long as the architect is interested in that. And I say that slightly plaintively, but that's just the reality. Because if you want something that has no seams and no nothing, which I understand, then it becomes either impossible or very expensive to do something else. So it's always a discussion. Especially with the tool, we are able to demonstrate what the result would be. And I get to meet an architect who wants a cacophonic space. It's just understanding how the material choice and the sound environment works together. You said something about performance, so of course a lot of gallery spaces do become performance spaces, and I think that's where it becomes slightly more complicated, or for that matter, media-driven exhibits, because there you're now talking about localized soundscaping or shaping that has a directional purpose of creating a certain sound. And I think it really comes back to a creative process that really understands that you're not just dumping something in. So very often we also work with exhibit designers, and when we're dealing with exhibit designers, you're in a fairly neutral space, you're putting in something that has partitioned surfaces, content that emits sound, but also surfaces that absorb sound. Sometimes we need to work with them on positioning. We have done virtual reality walkthroughs with sound to make sure that people understand how they'll react to it. And we really enjoy the creative process of saying, actually, sound can be part of wayfinding, sound can be part of not only about a question of intelligibility, but how you engage in space. If you have a big space, how do you get a sense of rationality or options of rationality? And that the way you want to engage with sound may be something that you want to curate. Is there a sound to the whole experience? Is there not? Is it, if it's a gallery, probably not. But if media comes in, do you want to be attracted to it, or do you want to not be bothered by it? these are choices that go beyond creating a neutral environment to actually choreographing, curating that experience. And that's something that absolutely can be done. You just have to want.
I think there's a relationship between color and sound.
Oh, yes.
It creates an expectation, though.
It does.
Certain kind of, you know, you walk into a space that's wood, you have a certain expectation in your mind, and if that expectation was not being met, there's an unsettling effect.
No, that's true. No, that's absolutely true. I think there's absolutely a connection, but I mean, bad acoustics and animal color, it's not white, is what I want to say. No, you're absolutely right. Also, people describe sound in colors. Even I describe sound. When we talk to our clients about what sort of sound they want, we use visual art as a medium very often of texture. I'm doing an opera house in Hanoi right now, and most of the way we're communicating with our clients, most of the time, is through examples of Vietnamese art as a way to describe the sound. Because the words that we use for sound are different, right? Because we don't. We're not used to it. So we use allegory very used to it.
Okay, we have a question in front row.
I'd like to ask a question about the relationship between architecture and the art market, and specifically about art fairs. So there's a big debate going on in the art world about the effects that art fairs are having on the sustainability of small and mid-sized galleries, many of whom are struggling to survive and compete with multinational mega galleries. At art fairs, there are often implicit hierarchies between smaller galleries and mega galleries, which is often expressed through booth placement and booth size. So I'd like to ask, what could architects do to create a more level playing field within the context of the art fair?
Very little. You know, it's like similar to an experience I had the other day doing the low income housing in Omaha in the US, and they went to a public discussion or public publication, and the audience asked me, how can architects solve the social equity issue? And my answer was, very little we can do there. Not that I don't care about this issue, I deeply care about those issues, and I have a lot of friends who are small gallery owners, thriving 10 years before in New York, and completely unsustainable these days, and they need the art fairs, so expensive. First, like, it demands financially, but also human resources and, you know, energy and all of that, so it's impossible if you don't have like a huge crew to do this all the time. So I think a lot of it's a structural issue, but we're thinking often what are the other ways of experiencing art and then to be connected with an art that's not only going to Chelsea and, you know, going to the art experience. So we do a lot of actually project also with community engagement and project that's artists, residencies in Brooklyn, Bushwick, for example. There's this consolidation of the money in the art market on one hand, but there's also this much more multifaceted way that art is embedding itself in society in this space. So hopefully, you know, over time, it will balance itself out. And as an architect, I think we just have to, you know, be willing to be engaged in these other projects as well, which we very much do.
May I ask you about the freeze experience? That was temporary, but repeated more than once, yes. But how was this? I mean, what is, let's say, the feedback from visitors?
So freeze, I think it's a 3 days that's non-public preview, and the 2 professional days, and then 2 days over the weekend is completely open to the public. And I went to log those 2 days that's not open, that's open to the public. And indeed, with Amanda and Matthew, the directors of Freeze, we talked a lot in the beginning when designing this, that we need to make it also a complex destination to be for everyone, all the New Yorkers. There's so many New Yorkers who are interested in art, and to open it up to the community in general is very important. So, you know, we brought in food trucks, we brought in terraces, you know. It's still a very specific group of New Yorkers, but indeed on the weekends, and they're just kids and, you know, people who just remotely interested in art are there, especially because it's also on the water, so it's a nice place to be. You can take a ferry to go there. So I think the curating of the experience to be open and accessible to a lot of people is very important design consideration.
And what about gallery owners?
The gallery owners? They get really tired by the third today.
I know, yes, I know about that. Yeah.
So, I mean, the business are still done during the first day.
But this year in Greece, you have problems with the temperature.
Yeah, we're not involved in the last 3 years.
So what is the rest?
Yeah, this year they actually brought the mechanical out of the floor, which is something really, really advised against, because if you think about it, to have cold air coming from above, and cold air always wants to, you know, rise, right? So it's just, and in this tent, because of the shape, it's really high. So you're trying to reach people from a really long distance, and it's just completely, you know, irrational. It's cheaper to do it that way. The cheapest way is not the always best way.
Yes? Third row, please.
Hi, I'm a student, and I want to ask a question that's not that much related to the talk, but I want to ask a personal opinion. I thought the topic was about relations between art and architecture. So, like, how art inspires architecture and how architecture influences art in, like, design process. So, do you have any idea about this in your developing process?
So, if we're talking about visual art, I'd say that from my perspective, actually architecture and visual art and sculpture are very closely related, and I've always had been, I think. I've had the pleasure of working with a wide range of architects since I started doing this work, and some have taken their inspiration wholly from architecture, not even from sculpture or architecture, and others very little. I think the thinking about space, texture, materiality is a process that has a lot in common with how the artists I know, sculptors and architects that I know, and a few friends think about space and materiality. So I would think it's quite close. For me, if I would take the concept of art a little bit broader, it really comes down to everything is about why. And what are you trying to say? So for me, the initial design process is very much about the same ethos as making an art. Then the engineering and the practical side comes in as an entire. And then the science of knowing what's gone in the past helps. But really it starts and ends in some way always with an artistic process.
We look at a lot of artists all the time. But you know, artists also work with a range of questions and a range of materials and mediums. So we actually find ourselves more gravitated towards artists that curate a certain experience and the human bodily experience, and artists experimenting with certain materials and the engineering techniques more production techniques to produce those experiences. So, I mean, I guess that's related to the production of experience in language as well. So, we also look at conceptual artists and not so much in how do we create an experience, but more asking the question. A lot of conceptual artists are asking really tough questions that people don't dare to ask these days in the world. And so we look at them and want to allow those questions to be answered or even confronted in our culture as well. So yeah, I think there is definitely a connection and overlap between art and language.
So is it? Wait for the microphone,
please. So how long does the stuff needs to last when you build? Because when you speak about Instagrammability or when you sort of the software to build the right sound, this is 1 year, 2 years, 10 years, how long? I mean, does architecture will live shorter? I mean, because of the needs of the time, maybe in 10 years we need different spaces or something, so you consider that you might build something that can be teared down in 10 years or so? Or do you build for eternity while you can build stuff? I mean, the tent is...
Yeah, it's our plan for the planning permission for 6 months.
Yeah.
Well, actually, most of the modernist architecture, as you know, were not made to last forever. And that's why there's such a big problem and expensive to preserve modernist architecture. I don't think you can this days to say that you design or build for eternity, because the practicality of the economy just doesn't allow for it. But it doesn't mean that it wouldn't last for a very long time. But I think it would just take generations and generations of users and people to appreciate it and willing to let it evolve and preserve it if it's indeed valuable to the community itself. It's a little bit out of our hands, I think. We cannot, there's not so many people who would invest to build architecture that lasts forever anymore these days, right? The economy is just not there, but...
I'm just seeing it the other way around. You build for shorter life cycles.
I think we have to build for the now.
Yeah.
But the now can keep on going. But that's a little bit out of our hands.
The way I would answer it is that it really depends on what the goal of the project is. So we certainly have pavilions and other things that are not intended to last. And we certainly have interior spaces that are intended to be replaced. But as a matter of philosophy, I think it really is a case-by-case situation to when you get asked to do a project. It's about that context in that project, and if it's something that where there's an aspiration, I have clients who actually say they want to honor your building. I do. At which point I think, well, that's not usual anymore, but it does happen. Of course, they're thinking about the structure, not about the finishes so much, but the reality is there are people who do invest with that in mind, and there are other people who say, I want this building to last for 6 months. And that certainly has a scalable effect on the amount of investment, but sometimes not necessarily that much. The more challenging thing, I think, these days is the people who want to be able to move a building. That becomes more interesting as well, because the whole idea of how you move it, how easy it is to move, how you store it, all of that becomes another layer that's quite interesting without it looking very damaged after.
Maybe this more than a question is we are asking for a recommendation. Maybe I work in a foundation, which is a art collection, and nowadays we are in a dilemma. We are searching for a place to put the collection. And a lot of questions we ask. One of them is maybe, well, as you all know, there's a thing called budget, and we don't have unlimited money. So we are trying to find the best place to put the collection. And one of them maybe is in the middle of the city, but it would be more expensive. less attractive than just physically. And the other one is to build something maybe out of the city and to invest more in architecture and design and technology. And the goal at last is to reach more people. So I don't know what you think of that, because if we are in the middle of the city, maybe more people will visit it, physically. But if we build something more attractive out of the city, we can reach more people through social media, through digital spaces, and make an icon of that an interesting point to visit.
I think it also depends on which city and how far outside of the city you're talking about.
We're talking about Chile, Santiago, which is a very small market. Nowadays, not a lot of people go to many places. So. That's, I don't know if you've been there, but that's the dynamic there nowadays.
Yeah, and it also depends on which audience you're trying to reach. For a lot of people, maybe an international audience, once they've gone to Chile, it's already a long way, so that doesn't really matter. I mean, if it's something that's unique and important enough, people will travel from all over the world to search for that experience, and if that experience is something that we go for, then you better actually deliver a really amazing experience, which can only be done maybe from what I hear, outside the city and not inside of the city. But if the collection's goal is to embed itself with the evolution of the culture of the city and people there, then it's a different story, I guess. So, as you know, there's no right and wrong answer for it. Yeah.
I do think there are good models for both, right? Which is interesting, and one of the processes that we would through are actually looking at different benchmarks and understanding what has worked and why, and then putting overlaying that on your committee and saying what are the factors that you want to offer and what you define. So for example, if it's a little bit further away, you need more amenities, does it have to be in a place that is actually more worth visiting, not just the building but context, or perhaps it's better to target something that is likely to get regenerated through time, and if because of that, perhaps there's a use of that, and the property is still cheaper, but actually it's actually cool, or you can make it cool. There's that. I also think, interestingly, we're seeing more examples of a bigger thought process where you might actually start to say, this is my core, but actually through property development, you are creating an environment that attracts more people over time. That may be food, maybe other things that actually create a center of gravity. And if you can do that and curate what that feels like, then maybe you are working more people to that place. So, as you say, lots of different models, no easy answer, but looking at the different models, I think sometimes can inspire us for different solutions that
But I do think in this case, time does matter, because if you think about the creating a very expensive and very well curated experience, that's hermetic, or more or less hermetic, there has to be certain structures for that to continue, because it's expensive to sustain it over time. And if you cannot, imagine 50 years from now, there's an endowment and the structure to keep that going, then maybe the operation needs to embed itself more within other constituencies. So, if the economy goes down, there's a traffic. There are many different modes of sustainability that can keep it going, even after the initial founders and this collection, there's a much longer span that you have.
I think that's right. I was just thinking about a historic brewery in the United Kingdom that's in the middle of nowhere. Every time I go there, it just takes me hours to go there. But it has always been a pilgrimage place for going, and they've created a performance space in there, and they have galleries, and they have food. And it was an estate that now has some fabrication homes. And so there's this cluster in this brewery that has been turned into a cluster where people go spend time on the weekend, they shop, they eat, they go to concert, they go to a gallery. That's what I mean in the sense that we're talking about is that if you're going to be further away, there has to be enough there to sustain them. But what I find interesting is that what we're seeing is a model is actually the arts organization is the developer of all that. Right? So now the sustainability of the arts organization is dependent, and the delivery of the mission is dependent on the abilities in property development and restaurants and other things that you can bring in, but as a model, it's a different economic model. It's quite interesting.
Great. Great.
Great.
Great. Great. Great.
Years.
So, talking about time, now I think it's time for our end of the talk. So, I appreciate very, very much for your presentations and sharing your reflections. And for our audience, the following talk will be at 2 o'clock. And Packing Galleries will be back tomorrow, also again at 11 o'clock in the morning with 3 sessions. Addressing the art world, art market, collecting public practices, and communication in the art. So look forward to seeing you. And again, Tateo and Jing, thank you very much for joining us.